Within the walls of Warren Correctional Institution in Lebanon, Ohio, Donald Harvey, inmate number A199449, a self-professed angel of death, is serving out four consecutive life sentences. From April 1983 to September 1986, while working as an orderly for Drake Memorial Hospital in Cincinnati, Ohio, Harvey committed a series of murders. It has been nearly 35 years since Harvey's arrest and conviction, and many questions remain. Why had such a seemingly bright and ambitious man taken it upon himself to play God with the lives of so many? Were these true mercy killings, as he claimed, or were they nothing more than an outlet for a twisted man to achieve a sick form of gratification? Donald Harvey was born in Butler County, Ohio in 1952. Shortly after his birth, Harvey's parents relocated to Boonville, Kentucky, a small community nestled away on the eastern slopes of the Appalachian Mountains. In an August 14, 1987 interview with Cincinnati Post reporter Nadine Luthen, Harvey's mother, Goldie Harvey, recalled that her son was brought up in a loving family environment. "My son has always been a good boy," she said. Martha D. Turner, who was principal of the elementary school Harvey attended for 8 years, backed up McKinney's comments in her own interview with the Cincinnati Post. "Donnie was a very special child to me," she said. "He was always clean and well-dressed, with his hair trimmed. He was a happy child, very sociable and well-liked by the other children. He was a handsome boy with big brown eyes and dark curly hair. He always had a smile for me. There was never any indication of any abnormality." Former classmates of Harvey described him as a loner and a teacher's pet. He rarely participated in extracurricular activities, opting instead to read books and dream about the future. Following his graduation from Sturgeon Elementary School, Harvey entered Boonville High School in 1968. Earning A's and B's in most classes with little effort, he became bored with the daily routine and dropped out. Having no real goals, Harvey was not sure what he wanted to do with his newfound freedom. For unknown reasons, he eventually decided to relocate to Cincinnati, Ohio, where he secured a job at a local factory. In 1970, work began to slow at the plant, and Harvey was eventually laid off. His mother called him a few days later and asked him to travel to Kentucky and visit his ailing grandfather, who was recently placed in a hospital there. Harvey agreed and within days set off to Marymount Hospital in London, Kentucky. Although no one knew it at the time, this trip would later prove to be the beginning of a long journey into madness and murder. While in Kentucky, Harvey spent much of his time at Marymount Hospital and was soon well known and liked by the nuns who worked there. During one particular conversation, one of the nuns asked Harvey if he would be interested in working there as an orderly. Since he was currently unemployed and didn't want another factory job, Harvey agreed and started work the next day. Although he was not a trained nurse or doctor, Harvey's duties required him to spend hours alone with patients. Some of his duties included changing bedpans, inserting catheters, and passing out medications. Harvey's first few weeks at the hospital were uneventful, but something snapped within him along the way. To this day, criminal psychologists are unable to explain what brought out his murderous tendencies. Whether he was unable to cope with the pain and suffering around him, or simply enjoyed watching his victims die, may never be known. According to Harvey's later confessions, he considered himself an angel of death, or mercy killer. But the details he eventually revealed about his first murder negate that self-serving description. During an evening shift, just months after starting at the hospital, Donald Harvey committed his first murder. Years later, in a 1997 interview with Cincinnati Post reporter Dan Horn, Harvey described it. When he walked into a private room to check on a stroke victim, the patient rubbed feces in his face. Harvey became angry and lost all control. "The next thing I knew, I'd smothered him," he said. "It was like it was the last straw. I just lost it. I went in to help the man, and he wants to rub that in my face." Following the murder, Harvey cleaned up the patient and hopped into the shower before notifying the nurses. "No one ever questioned it," he said. Just 3 weeks after committing his first murder, he killed again when he disconnected an oxygen tank at an elderly woman's bedside. As the weeks went by and no one detected foul play in his first two murders, Harvey became more brazen. Whether out of boredom, opportunity, or experimentation, His methods varied with each murder. He used various items, such as plastic bags, morphine, and a variety of drugs, to kill more than a dozen patients in a year. In one case, he chose an exceptionally brutal method. The patient had an argument with Harvey because he thought Harvey was trying to kill him, and during the course of that argument, he reportedly knocked Harvey out with a bedpan. Upon recovering from the blow, Harvey waited till later that night, snuck into the patient's room, and stuck a coat hanger through his catheter. As a result of the puncture, infection set in and the man died a few days later. On March 31, 1971, a drunk and disorderly Harvey was arrested for burglary. While being questioned about the crime, Harvey began babbling incoherently about the murders he had committed. The arresting officers looked into his claims and questioned him extensively about them, but in the end, they were unable to find any substantial evidence to back them up or charge him with any crime relating to them. A few weeks later, he went to trial for the burglary charges and pleaded guilty to a reduced charge of petty theft. After paying a small fine for his indiscretion, Harvey decided it was time for another change of scenery and enlisted in the United States Air Force. Harvey served less than a year in the Air Force before he received a general discharge in March 1972. His records list unspecified grounds for the discharge, but it was widely rumored at the time that his superiors had learned of his confessions to the Kentucky police and did not want to deal with any similar matters in the future. After his release from the military, Harvey dealt with several bouts of depression. By July 1972, he was unable to control his inner demons and decided to commit himself to the Veterans Administration Medical Center in Lexington, Kentucky. Harvey remained in the mental ward of the facility until August 25th, but then admitted himself again a few weeks later. Following a bungled suicide attempt in the hospital, Harvey was placed in restraints and over the course of the next few weeks, received 21 electroshock therapy treatments. On October 17, 1972, Harvey was again released from the hospital. Goldie Harvey later condemned the hospital for releasing her son so abruptly, feeling that he had shown no apparent signs of improvement from the time of his admittance. Harvey spent the next few months trying to get his life back in order and eventually found work as a part-time nurse's aide at Cardinal Hill Hospital in Lexington. In June 1973, he started a second nursing job at Lexington's Good Samaritan Hospital. Harvey kept both jobs until August 1974, when he took up a job as a telephone operator and then secured a clerical job at St. Luke's Hospital in Fort Thomas, Kentucky. According to his later confessions, Harvey was able to control his urge to kill during this time. The more feasible explanation would be that he did not have the same access to the patients as he did at Marymount Hospital, which could also explain why he shifted from job to job during this time. The majority of serial killers are opportunists, and Donald Harvey was a man with few opportunities. He had not yet evolved enough to take his urges outside of the place he felt safe in committing his crimes, the dimly lit patient rooms, his killing sanctuaries. Harvey was a different kind of hunter, and in order for him to get hold of his prey, he had to first find the right environment. In September 1975, Harvey moved back to Cincinnati, Ohio. Within weeks, he got a job working a night shift at the Cincinnati VA Medical Hospital. Harvey's duties varied, and he performed several different tasks, depending on where he was needed at the time. He worked as a nursing assistant, housekeeping aide, cardiac catheterization technician, and autopsy assistant. Harvey had found his niche and wasted little time in starting where he'd left off. Since he worked at night, he had very little supervision and unlimited access to virtually all areas of the hospital. Over the next 10 years, Harvey murdered at least 15 patients while working at the hospital. He kept a precise diary of his crimes and took notes on each victim, detailing how he murdered them, pressing a plastic bag and wet towel over the mouth and nose, sprinkling rat poison in a patient's dessert, adding arsenic and cyanide to orange juice, injecting cyanide into an intravenous tube, injecting cyanide into a patient's buttocks. All the while Harvey was committing his crimes, he was refining his techniques by studying medical journals for underlying hints on how to conceal his crimes. Over the years, he amassed an astounding 30 pounds of cyanide, which he had slowly pilfered from the hospital and kept at home for safekeeping. Typically, Harvey would mix a vial of cyanide or arsenic at home and then bring it to work. When no one was around, he would slip the mixture into his victim's food or pour it directly into their gastric tube. The early 1980s brought about variations in Harvey's methods. He moved in with a gay lover, Carl Hoeller, and soon began poisoning him out of fear that his mate was cheating on him. Harvey would slip small doses of arsenic into Hoeller's food so that he would be too ill to leave their apartment. Harvey's confidence was hitting peak levels, and he began feeling as though he was unstoppable. On one occasion, following an argument with a female neighbor, Harvey laced one of her beverages with hepatitis serum, nearly killing her before the infection was diagnosed and treated. Another neighbor, Helen Metzger, was not so lucky. Harvey put arsenic in one of her pies, and she died later that week at a local hospital. In April 1983, Harvey had a squabble with Hoeller's parents and began to poison their food with arsenic. On May 1, 1983, Hoeller's father, Henry, suffered a stroke and was remitted to Providence Hospital. Harvey visited Henry Hoeller there and placed arsenic in his pudding before leaving. Hoeller died later that night. Harvey continued to poison Carl's mother, Margaret, off and on for the next year, but was unsuccessful in his attempts to kill her. In January 1984, Hoeller broke off the relationship with Harvey and asked him to move out. Harvey was angry at the rejection and spent the next 2 years trying to kill Hoeller with his poisonous concoctions. At one point, he even tried to kill a female friend of Hoeller as a way to get his revenge. While neither attempt worked, he did manage to land Hoeller in the hospital at one point as a result of the poisons he had unknowingly ingested. While leaving work on July 18, 1985, security guards noticed Harvey acting suspiciously and decided to search a gym bag he was carrying with him. Inside the satchel, the guards discovered a .38 caliber pistol, hypodermic needles, surgical scissors and gloves, a cocaine spoon, various medical texts, two occult books, and a biography of serial killer Charles Sobrage. Fined $50 for carrying a firearm on federal property, Harvey was then given the option to quietly resign from his job rather than being fired. Nothing about the incident was ever noted in his work record, and hospital authorities did not investigate whether Harvey had committed any other crimes while working at the hospital. 7 months later, in February 1986, Harvey once again got work at a local hospital. This time he was hired as a part-time nurse's aide at Cincinnati's Drake Memorial Hospital. His new employers were unaware of the incident at his previous job, and his work folder said nothing but good things about him. Harvey soon earned a full-time position at the hospital and settled back into his old routine. Over the next 13 months, Harvey murdered another 23 patients by disconnecting life support machines, injecting air into veins, suffocation, and injections of arsenic, cyanide, and petroleum-based cleaners. Authorities became suspicious of Harvey in April 1987 after the death of John Powell, a patient who was comatose for several months but had since started to recover. An assistant coroner noticed the faint scent of almonds during the autopsy, the telltale sign of cyanide. Authorities could not find any evidence or motive pointing toward any of Powell's friends or family members, so they soon began to focus on hospital employees who had access to Powell's room. The list was short, and upon learning Donald Harvey's hospital nickname, Angel of Death, given to him because he always seemed to be around when someone died, authorities began to focus their entire investigation on him. In April 1987, after securing a search warrant for Harvey's apartment, investigators found a mountain of evidence against him. Jars of cyanide and arsenic, books on the occult and poisons, and a detailed account of the murder, which he had written in a diary. Following this new discovery of evidence, Harvey was arrested on one count of aggravated murder, and after filing a plea of not guilty by reason of insanity, was held under $200,000 bond. The evidence against Harvey was growing rapidly, and investigators were beginning to look into several other mysterious deaths at the hospital. Harvey realized that it was only a matter of time before they discovered the full extent of his crimes and decided he should try to make a plea bargain to avoid Ohio's death penalty. On August 11, 1987, 35-year-old Harvey sat down with investigators and confessed to committing 33 murders over the past 17 years. As the days went by, that number eventually grew to 70 in all. Investigators were skeptical of the numbers Harvey was giving them and wanted to have his mental state assessed prior to taking his claims as fact. Following several psychiatric tests by numerous experts, a spokesman for the Cincinnati Prosecutor's Office explained the dilemma to the Cincinnati Post. "This man is sane, competent, but is a compulsive killer," he said. "He builds up tension in his body, so he kills people." Donald Harvey entered the courtroom on August 18, 1987, and pled guilty to 24 counts of aggravated murder, 4 counts of attempted murder, and 1 count of felonious assault. Just 4 days later, a 25th guilty plea earned him a total of 4 consecutive 20 years to life sentences. In addition to his life terms, Harvey was fined $270,000. Harvey was indicted in Kentucky on September 7, 1987, where he confessed to committing 12 murders while employed at Marymount Hospital. In November, he pleaded guilty and was sentenced to 8 life terms plus 20 years. In February 1988, he entered guilty pleas on 3 additional Cincinnati homicides and 3 attempted murders, drawing 3 life sentences plus 3 terms of 7 to 25 years. 2 years later, the investigation into the remaining deaths was closed after investigators determined that there was not enough evidence to pursue them. In a 1991 interview with a reporter from the Columbus Dispatch, Harvey gave a rare glimpse into his mindset. "Why do you kill?" "Well, people controlled me for 18 years, and then I controlled my own destiny. I controlled other people's lives, whether they lived or died. I had that power to control. What right did you have to decide that? After I didn't get caught for the first 15, I thought it was my right. I appointed myself judge, prosecutor, and jury. So I played God." On July 23, 2001, the Associated Press printed an article listing the worst serial killers in the United States. Donald Harvey was rated number 1, followed by John Wayne Gacy, Patrick Kearney, Bruce Davis, and Dean Corll. Donald Harvey's first scheduled parole hearing was set for 2047. He would have been 95. One would think that cases such as Harvey's and Shipman's would galvanize the medical community worldwide to develop procedures to safeguard against murder in medical institutions. However, discoveries of serial murders within hospitals have risen drastically over the years. The number of victims these serial killers are able to claim before attracting attention strains credibility. British doctor Harold Shipman is one of the world's most prolific serial killers, claiming at least 215 victims. The list of medics who kill and their number of victims continues to grow. Richard Angelo, Long Island, New York, at least 10 murders. Orville Lynn Majors, Clinton, Indiana, at least 130 murders. Roberto Diaz, Riverside, California, 12 murders. Brian Rosenfeld, Florida, 23 possible murders. Michael Swango, New York, at least 4 murders. Efren Saldivar, California, at least 6 murders. Beverly Allitt, Britain, at least 4 murders. Janine Jones, Texas, at least 20 murders. Jane Toppin, Massachusetts, at least 31 murders. Woltraud Wagner, Maria Gruber, Eileen Liedolf, and Stefania Meyer, all from Vienna, at least 15 murders. The previous list is far from inclusive and does not address the hundreds of suspicious deaths of patients in hospitals and nursing homes. Until hospital employees are screened effectively, staff members are trained to be more vigilant, hospital administrations are more receptive to investigating suspicious cases at an early stage, and stricter regulations are put in place, these crimes will continue to plague justice systems around the world. Well-known forensic scientist Henry Lee summed it up quite well on April 29, 2002, in an interview he gave to the Los Angeles Times regarding Efren Saldivar and similar crimes. He said murders committed by hospital staff were the easiest kind of serial killing to get away with. "You have to figure out who the victims were long after they're buried," he said. "You have to dig up bodies. You're going to have a difficult time finding true trace drugs or elements in there. The next issue is how to link to the suspect. Why him? What's the proof? Prepare to fail." On March 28, 2017, authorities reported that Harvey had been found in his cell severely beaten. He died on March 30, 2017. On May 3, 2019, fellow inmate James Elliott was charged with aggravated murder and other charges related to the death of Donald Harvey. Elliott was serving time in the Toledo Correctional Institution for burglary and assault. He admitted to plotting the assault on Harvey for at least a week because he received kosher meals fitting Jewish dietary law. He waited to see what officers were on shift because Elliott believed some kept better watch than others. Elliott brought a shank to Harvey's cell with plans to stab him, but had to change plans because the angel of death screamed. He entered Harvey's cell, pulled the door closed behind him, and attacked Harvey. Staff were alerted to the situation when they heard screaming coming from the area of Harvey's cell. They investigated and found him unresponsive and bleeding. They found Elliot later with blood on his shoes and clothing. Elliot did not initially admit to assaulting Harvey. Later, he did admit, according to the report, that he had kicked Harvey in the head multiple times after punching him and knocking him to the ground. Two things principally motivated the prison attack on Harvey, Elliot wrote. First, it was a way to get the attention of prison officials because he was unhappy with the food being served by the institution and that complaints and grievances were not getting their attention. He contacted the News Journal, via letter, in 2018, admitting to the murder. While he declined to comment in court, Elliot did write about the killing in his letter. Hopefully, everyone from our area will take some solace in the fact that one of their own gave Harvey the punishment that he should have gotten from the courts. I picked Harvey because I knew it would give them a better understanding of just how unhappy we, myself and the other inmates in the institution, were about the food. Elliot also said that killing one of America's most well-known serial killers would enable him to do something constructive for the friends and neighbors he robbed and stole from and never gave anything in return. I was born and raised in the Knox-Whitley County area and more than likely knew of some distant relative of one of his victims in the Laurel County area, Elliot wrote. I guess a part of me saw this as an opportunity to finally do something constructive for my neighbors by way of closure, and in turn, balance the karmic scales in my favor. No matter how bad a person is, that does not give you the right to be the judge, jury, and executioner, Judge Duhart told Elliot. No one has that right except the Lord above. In September 2019, Elliot was sentenced to life in prison after pleading guilty to killing Harvey.